great, how awesome is he, and together we sing, holy is the Lord.
Heard that on Wednesday we have adult Bible study. Every Sunday we at 9 a.m. we have Sunday school, and then worship service, of course, at 10 a.m. Other announcements, worship the Lord with your tithes and offerings and place them in the box on the table right back there every Sunday, or you could do it other days as well. Our missionary for the month of February is the Child Evangelism Fellowship. That's the five-day club at Hoover Elementary. I think I have to get closer. That's what my sound team back there is saying. Calvary Adult Choir, the sign-up sheet is in the foyer back on the table. Awaiting your name, plan on at least 4 one-hour rehearsals after the church service each Sunday on March 12th, March 19th, March 26th, and April 2nd, performing on Easter Sunday. The music will be distributed very, very soon. Calvary Kids Choir, the sign-up sheet is on the foyer as well. The practices will be the last few Sundays in March during the Children's Church, and that will be performing on Easter Sunday as well. Music will be distributed, and the links for the songs will be sent soon. And we need more people for the sound team, per Brad, so sign up for that. If I can do it, anyone can do it. I'm the most basic person alive, so I think you all can do it as well. As a reminder, next week, our church potluck. Scott told me to make sure I mention that. It's next Sunday right after church. Bring a dish to pass out, or a dessert. All side dishes are welcome.
When is the potluck?
It's next Sunday.
When is the potluck?
Next Sunday.
People come up to me all the time. They say, oh, I forgot it was potluck. Well, you can't say that now, all right? Second Sunday, everyone.
And we make it easy. It's right after the service. So all are welcome. So bring family, friends, guests. At our annual meeting last week, we voted in the new members or following members for elders, Steve Hansen, Scott Sawyer, and then deacons, Chris Holliday, Brandon Ramsey, Mike Roberts, Brad Weber, and myself. So congratulations to the elders.
These men are stepping forward to be part of our leadership team, and it's going to be insane. But it'll be good. It'll help the church. So that's awesome. Thank you, guys.
And then last but not least, our church directory is available on the foyer back there. And if you turn to page 8, you can see my picture. And draw whatever you want on it. Feel free. There we go. Pastor, I believe you have a few words.
You're going to throw it to me? Okay. Well, just a couple of things I want to clarify. One of them is that you've noticed lately we've been doing some kind of newish music. Hey, good to see you guys. Haven't seen you for a while. When someone up here starts a song and they're singing by themselves, you're supposed to sing, okay? It's not a special. We're in the worship set and we're just trying to build some dynamics into the music so we're not all just singing all the time. But if someone's up there singing during the worship set, that means you're supposed to join in and sing too, if you feel like it, okay? So I'm clarifying that. We also wanted to say that for those we're looking for at the tech team or the sound team up there, this is not for men, okay? This is for anyone. So if you've got some technical abilities, a good ear for music, Daryl has joined the team up there, and yet we could still use one or two more so that we can rotate and people can have weeks off and sit with their wives or this and that during the service. So keep that in mind. It's not just for guys. It's for anyone who can join in. Another thing is members. Our next opportunity, I guess, to bring new members into the church would be in April, our quarterly meeting in April, near the end of April. So if you want to be joining the church, then you've got an application to fill out, and we do a little interview with you and that sort of thing. So come and see me or one of our leaders, and there are lots of guys to choose from now. And then also baptisms. If you haven't been baptized in faithfulness to the Lord, he commands that once we're saved, we be baptized in his name and declare publicly that we are his child. So we're going to try, if enough people come forward, that we can put a baptismal Sunday in there somewhere around Easter. It may even be Easter Sunday, like we did last year. And that was so wonderful to do that right on Easter Sunday. So keep that in mind. Come and see me. And I've got a sheet that explains what believer's baptism is. If you were baptized as an infant, well, we think there's no harm in coming and being baptized as an actual believer where you've chosen Christ as a grown person. And so it's believer's baptism, right? Not just something you do as an infant, all right? And so we've got some teaching on that I can hand you. I also want to encourage the parents for Sunday school again. You know, we're down there. Faithy's teaching this morning, and little Hadley's down there with her, and that kid is so smart. I'll tell you what. 2 weeks ago, I came and asked her after the service up here with her parents sitting there, you know, well, did you like Sunday school? Yeah. You like Miss Faith teaching Sunday school? Yeah, it was great. Well, then what did you learn? Man, she told me the whole story, right from stem to stern. Daniel in the lion's den, she knew it cold. I mean, they're learning good things about Jesus Christ down there. And just to be here an hour early so your kids can be instructed in the Word and in the Lord, I will just say, come on. Why aren't you? Ask yourself that question, all right? Maybe I'm laying it a little thick, but that's because I'm warning you now. I love all of you, but this sermon today is going to be a little heavy hitting. So I'm just reminding you, getting you ready. And then we're also still looking for someone that's willing to take over, in a sense, the Wow Wednesday thing, so that we can get back to having adults come and be discipled in the Lord at the Wednesday Bible study, which is going great. And, you know, Dwayne's doing a wonderful job with that. And then, but they can have their kids downstairs, and someone can be teaching them about Jesus there, teaching them songs and all of these things. So we're still looking for someone that has a heart for that, heart for the kids, and recognizes the value and the importance of bringing our children up in the Lord. And I've got it really quiet in here now. So with that said, I thank you for hearing me out. Hey, I'm going to throw it back over to Daryl, and he's going to pray, and then we're going to start into our worship set. Thank you.
Dear Lord, we all know that this past week, it seemed like in the news, there's been a lot of craziness worldwide across the United States, but let's make sure that we keep our focus on our community. Let's keep our focus on the elderly that may not have people to go to. Let's help them. Let's help the children that may be wondering where their next meal's coming from. And any family that is out there that is struggling, let's keep them in our thoughts, because our community is where it starts. And as Pastor John always says, and all God's people said, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Daryl. Hey, you don't have to stand yet, okay? We're going to stand in a minute, but this is kind of like a real fun warm-up to a worship set, I think. And it's kind of like an old, you know, chorus from, I don't know, from the 80s or something, but there's nothing more fun to get you in the mood for singing than a bunch of cats, kittens flying across the stage. So let's go ahead and play that video, something that kids have downstairs. I just thought it was funny. And go ahead. Sing along if you know it. Make sure it's good and loud.
Hallelujah, 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 praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Don't be shy, crank it up back there. Put your hands up when the cat comes. Let's try it on the next verse. I love it.
It's Yippee Yahoo, way to go, God.
I know I'm insane. I just thought it was great. Hallelujah. Here we go.
Praise ye the Lord.
Where's your hands? Pretend you're kittens.
Praise ye the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise ye the Lord.
Oh, we lost it.
Now, was that hard to do? Come on. You had your hands in the air. Did it hurt? No, I don't think it did. All right, let's stand together. We're going to sing River of Life. Come on down to that river. You'll never be the same.
This is a clapping song.
Is this guitar playing out there? Can you hear it? Yeah. All right, here we go.
Brothers, sisters, Come on down to that river, guaranteed you'll never be the same. There's a fountain flowing from the heart of the Savior. Bring your sins and all your guilty stains. Let that river of life wash it all away.
Well, if you've been searching, carrying burdens, if you've been lost and looking for a home, if you've been drifting, something is missing, you should know that you are not alone. No,
brothers, sisters, come on down to that river, guaranteed you'll never be the same. There's a fountain flowing from the heart of the Savior. Bring your sins and all your guilty stains. Let that river of life wash it all away.
Come on down to the river. Come as you are, no time to waste. Open your heart, don't be afraid. Jump on in, the water is fine. It's healing in the river of life. Come as you are, no time to waste. Open your hearts, don't be afraid. Jump on in, the water is fine. There's healing in the river of life.
2, 3, 4,
and brothers, sisters, come on down to that river. I guarantee you'll never be the same.
There's a fountain flowing from the heart of the Savior. Bring your sins and all your guilty stains. Let that river of life wash it all away. Brothers, sisters, come on down to that river. Guarantee you'll never be the same. There's a from the heart of the Savior, bring your sins and all your guilty stains. By the blood of Jesus, everything will change. Let that river of life wash it all away.
Come on down to the river. Come on down to the river.
Let that river of life wash it all away.
Amen, amen.
From the highest of heights to the depths of the sea, creation's revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring, every creature unique in the song that it sings, all exclaiming, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God. Who has told every lightning bolt where it should go? Or seen heavenly storehouses laden with snow? Who imagined the sun and gives source to its light, yet conceals it to bring us the coolness of night? None can fathom, indescribable, uncontainable,
You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God. You are amazing, God. Indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. Incomparable, unchangeable, you see the depths of my heart and you love me the same. You see the depths of my heart and you love me the same. You see the depths of my heart, yet you love me the same. 'Cause you are amazing, God. You are amazing, God. You are amazing.
Heavenly Father, thank you for this beautiful day that you've given us, for this in the dead of winter, snow all around us, a half inch of snow shutting down Texas. We praise you for the beautiful day we have here. We praise you for all the people you've seen that wake up in the morning and come here to this church on a day where they could be doing anything. They've chosen to be here with you, with us. We thank you for that. We thank you for the opportunity to praise you. We thank you for the opportunity to spend time together with you, to spend time together with fellow brother and sister Christians the way you have instructed us to do. We praise you for this day. We praise you for the time together. We just ask that you just give your word today. Let it be pastor's words. Let it be those, but let them be your words and let them speak to our hearts. We pray these things in your blessed name. Amen.
Amen.
There is a truth older than the ages. There is a promise of things yet to come. There is one born for our salvation, Jesus, Jesus. There is a light that overwhelms the darkness. There is a kingdom that forever reigns. Freedom from the chains that bind us. Jesus, Jesus, who walks on the waters, who speaks to the sea, who stands in the fire beside me. He roars like a lion, he bled. There is a name I call in times of trouble. There is a song that comforts in the night. There's a voice that calms the storm that rages. He is Jesus, Jesus, who walks on the waters, who speaks to the sea, who stands in the fire beside me. He roars like a lion, he bled as a lamb, he carries my healing in his hands. Oh, Jesus, Messiah, my Savior, there is power in your name. My rock and my Redeemer, there is power in your name, in your name. Messiah, my Savior, yeah, there is power in your name. You're my rock and you're my Redeemer. You stand in the fire beside me. You roar like a lion, you bled as a lamb, you carry my healing in your hands. God, you walk on the waters, you speak to the sea, you stand in the fire beside me. You roar like a lion, you bled as a lamb, you carry my healing in your hands. Jesus, there is no one like you, Jesus. There is no one like you, Jesus.
Oh, can you all say hallelujah? Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Thank you. You may be seated.
We have another song.
And now you can stand back up again.
Give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord, it's your breath. Great are you, Lord. So we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise, it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, you only.
All the earth will shout.
And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise, it's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise, it's your breath.
Thank you.
And surprise, you are not rid of me yet. As everybody gets seated, you'll notice that today is the first Sunday of the month, therefore Communion Sunday. And I've been asked to give a little, as people do each time, talk a bit about communion. This one's going to be a little different because I think about when I was a child in the little country church that I went to, communion was a very serious event. It was as close to Catholic as we ever got. It was very solemn. And everything was handled very quietly. And as a child, you really learn to respect this moment, to venerate this moment, because it was so important to us all. It was so important to everybody. What was it?
Closer to the mic.
Closer to the mic. Okay. It was serious, but in another way, it scared us. It scared us because of the words that were used. It frightened us. Even as young people, we understood that at this moment, there were certain things. There were penalties for doing this wrong. When we read through. So I went back to take a look at this, what made things so different, what made it so scary for me then, and not so much now. We go to 1 Corinthians 11, verse 23. We find that Paul starts talking about this. He starts talking about the communion ceremony. Remember, Paul wasn't there. All the other disciples were there. Paul wasn't there. Paul lays the groundwork, though, and says, that he received this from Jesus Christ. He received a revelation, the revelation from Jesus Christ. All that means is a divine disclosure. God told him something. We don't know how that happened, but we know it did. He says it in Galatians 1:12, for I did not learn this from a human source, but by revelation from Jesus Christ. He got the whole story. So we have in 1 Corinthians 11, we have a lot of the warnings that come with this. We have verse 27, whoever eats the bread and drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. That's very serious. We can jump down to 29 and see, for the one who eats and drinks without careful regard for the body eats and drinks judgment upon himself. That almost sounds worse, as if it could get worse from the first one. Those verses, when I was young, seemed very punitive. They seemed very harsh. And now that I'm older, I'm starting to see that it isn't exactly what I thought. It's still serious, don't get me wrong, but it's not exactly what I thought. Because in this, interspersed within 1 Corinthians 11, God gives us the way out. God gives us what he really wants from us and what the way out of this harsh judgment is. First of all, when I was a kid and the pastor would speak before this, it was always about making sure we were worthy, coming to being, standing righteous before God when you do this. And I've got news for you. It's not going to happen. None of you today, starting with me, nobody out there is going to be worthy of this. Nobody was worthy of the sacrifice of the living God on the cross. No one stands righteous before God right now. You are not sinless. 1 John 1:8 makes it very clear. You are not sinless. Romans 3:10 makes it clear. You are not righteous. Without the blood of Jesus on you, you are none of these things, and you never will be. This isn't about you being worthy to come up and take the cup, because you're not. So don't feel bad about that. It's just the way it is. When we go to 28, we find one of the ways out. We find that you examine. A person should examine himself, and that way let him eat and drink. What's that word examine mean? Well, when you find examined in the New Testament, one of the many uses of it, Paul was examined with a whip. It was not just... That may or may not be me, I don't know. But it's not looking in a mirror, it's not seeing how you're dressed, it's not seeing what you look like. Examining is internal, it is deep. It is you looking within yourself, allowing God to look within you and point to what he does not like. That's what this is. If we examine ourselves, or verse 28, 1 Corinthians 11, verse 28, examine, a person should examine himself and that way let him eat and drink. You're looking inside of yourself for what it is that's separating you from God at that moment. Verse 31, if we examine ourselves, we will not be judged again. Examining, getting deep though, this isn't shallow, this is heavy, this is deep. This is going into the spots you don't want to go. This is letting God take you into the spots you don't want to go and finding out what it is you need to do. But there's more, as there always is, isn't there? One thing about the Word of God is it's never simple. When God wants it simple, it's simple. And in this case, there is a lot more here. Verse 29, for the one who eats and drinks without careful regard for the body, eats and drinks judgment upon himself. What is he talking about? Careful regard of the body? A lot of people interpret this as being the body of Christ, that you're not having proper respect for the body. It's possible. But I think giving what we learned below, this body refers to the body of Christ, the people, us, your fellow Christian brothers and sisters. If you eat and drink without careful regard for everyone, for the body of Christ, for how you are edifying the body of Christ, it's bigger than just you. This is a spiritual gut check. This is that moment where you have to say, before you come up to do this, you have to ask yourself, are you a true believer? Are you a follower of our Lord Jesus Christ? Have you been saved? Are you a disciple? Because that's what it means. That's what it means. Are you a disciple? Christians only mentioned in the New Testament 3 times, disciples over 250. Disciple is what's important here. You can identify yourself as a Christian, but are you a disciple? That's what God's looking for. If you believe who he is, that he is who he said he is, then are you ready to follow him? Are you ready to follow his commandments? Which we know that the things, when asked, the two most important ones were, love God with all your heart, strength, soul. Love others as yourself. The body of Christ. Love the body of Christ. And that takes you right out of 31. Circles you right back to 29. For he who eats and drinks without careful regard for the body. At this time, you can read in this, when you read the rest of this, you'll see that there is some context. People were not loving each other. People were being problematic, as people are, in these feasts, in these meals that they shared together. And Paul was upset. God was upset. People, rich people were disrespecting poor people. Poor people possibly. We don't know everything that was happening, but we know there was disrespect and bad treatment within the body of Christ, and that made God mad, and it made Paul mad, and that's why it's in here. You need to, before you take this cup, are you a sinner? Absolutely. That's why you're here. Are you imperfect? Absolutely. Are you righteous? No. Are you worthy? No. Sorry. But you can still do this if you examine yourself and you find that in your heart you are a disciple. You are ready to follow Jesus. You are there. You are looking at God and saying, what can I do to be better? Find those things in me that you want gone and help me make them gone. If that's where you're at, then this is for you. Thank you.
Yeah, a lot of good words. Very on point, I would say, for today. This is a special time. We get to come and commune with the Lord once a month on the first Sunday of the month, so I'm so glad you're here today. So let's begin with our front rows and just come up and take the elements and then head back around the outsides, probably. Thank you, Lord, for this time together. Oh, you can come as the body of Christ, the bride of Christ. As Scott said, unrighteous on our own behalf, but righteous because of you. What a plan. What a mystery. What a wonderful Savior we have. And this morning, Lord, we thank you from the bottom of our hearts. If you have your elements there, the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. So do this in remembrance of me. And so in remembrance of him this morning as the body of Christ, let's partake together. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." And it goes on to say, as Scott was saying, "For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink from the cup. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eat and drink judgment on themselves." So we are to examine ourselves. I hope you've done that this morning and reconnected with the Lord of creation, the Lord of our hearts, the Lord of our salvation. Let's partake together.
There's torn up pages in this book, words that tell me I'm no good, chapters that defined me for so long. But the hands of grace and endless love dusted off and picked me up, told my heart that hope is never gone. God is in this story. God is in the details, even in the broken parts. He holds my heart, he never fails. When I'm at my weakest, I will trust in Jesus. Always in the highs and lows, the one who goes before me. God is in this story.
So if the storm you're walking through feels like it's too much and you wonder if he even cares at all, well, hold on tight to what you know. He promised he won't let you go. The song of healing's written in his scars.
God is in this story. God is in the details, even in the broken hearts. He holds my heart, he never fails. When I'm at my weakest, I will trust in Jesus. Always in the highs and lows, the one who goes before me. God is in this story. Healer of all things. If it reads like depression, if it reads broken home, he's the one who holds your sorrow. He won't leave you here alone. God is in this story. God is in the details. Even in the broken parts, he holds my heart.
He never fails. When I'm at my weakest, I will trust in Jesus. Always in the highs and lows, the one who goes before me. Always in the highs and lows, the one.
God is in this story.
Yes, you're in this story.
God is in this story. right here in my story.
Good job. Well, as I mentioned earlier, I hope you brought your steel-toed boots today, okay? It's been said that if you don't get your toes stepped on when you go to church, you haven't been to church. All right, so get ready to listen this morning. And let me start off this morning with an opening statement, or our big idea, if you like. If you and I are not reading the Bible on a regular basis, then we will never know its truth, and therefore, we won't grow in truth. If you want to shorten that up a bit, you could say, if you don't read, you'll never know, and you won't grow. According to Barna's survey of church-attending Christians, 82% thought that the phrase, God helps those who help themselves, was from the Bible. Is it in the Bible?
No.
No, it's not in the Bible. But you wouldn't know that if you haven't read the Bible. It's not in the Bible. 63% couldn't name the four Gospels. Can you name them? Go ahead. Right. That's it. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Of course you know those. And over half of the people in the survey, they didn't know the book of Jonah was even in the Bible. Okay? Obviously, they hadn't been to Faithy's Sunday school class because she talks about the whale and the spitting him out on the beach and all of that kind of stuff. You know, it's awesome. But another similar poll discovered that 12% of adults believe that Joan of Arc was Noah's wife. Joan of the Ark, you know? That makes sense. And according to a survey of high school seniors, over 50% of them believe that Sodom and Gomorrah were husband and wife. They just thought they were like a pair, husband and wife, okay? So this reminds me of this young pastor who had to fill in and teach a boys' Sunday school class, which I've been in that position many times. So he decided to see how much these kids actually knew about the Bible. So he asked them, who knocked down the walls of Jericho? And immediately, all the boys in unison said, well, we didn't do it. And the young preacher, he was so saddened because they didn't know the right answer. He decided to bring it up at the church business meeting. And lamented, not one of those boys knew who knocked down the walls of Jericho. The members were silent at first, all the leaders sitting around, and then finally one seasoned saint spoke up and said, Pastor, I can see this is really bothering you a lot, but I've known those boys since they were born, and they're good boys. If they said they don't know who did it, I believe them. Let's just take some money out of the general fund and fix the walls, and let that be enough. So even the leaders didn't really know the answer, okay? But it just kind of, doesn't it make you wonder how we would fare if we were asked these questions? You know, so then what's the problem? What is the problem? Well, maybe this video will help us get a picture. Thank you. That can hit home. What was the name of Balaam's donkey? Anyone know? His name was Donkey. He didn't have a name, okay? I was ready for someone to pop out with a name, you know, like Jeremiah or something like that. No, he didn't even have a name. But, you know, I mean, are we in our Bible or aren't we? So that's the basic topic for today. Professor and author Ed Stetzer wrote a blog post a few years back called Biblical Illiteracy. And here's part of what he said. Both inside and outside the church, there is a problem. Non-Christians don't even have a general idea of what's in the Bible like they once did a few generations back. And Christians aren't seeing the life change that real Bible engagement can bring. The result is a nation in spiritual freefall. There's no excuse. It's not as if we don't have access. The average American, Christian or not, owns at least 3 Bibles. How many do you have? Even those who don't have one in their home can download it free for their, you know, on their smartphone, various other tablet or whatever. The Word of God is more available to us than ever. People have died to bring us what has led to modern translations of the Scriptures, yet we are dying spiritually from a lack of knowledge. Simply put, we have biblical literacy deficit, in part because we have a spiritual maturity deficit. Ouch. Plenty of research shows the correlation between spiritual maturity and reading the Bible. If you want spiritually mature Christians, then get them reading the Scriptures. Reading and studying the Bible are still the activities that have the most impact on growth in this area of spiritual maturity. As basic as that is, he says, there are still numerous churchgoers who aren't reading the Bible regularly. The simple fact is that you won't grow spiritually if you don't know God and you don't spend time in His Word, because that's where you find out about Him. That's where you know His ways, His thinking, what He wants you to do. It's in the book. It's in the book. Okay, so pretty heavy beginning today, and it's not going to get better, I don't think. But in light of all that, our message today is called Drinking the Bible, okay? Just picture yourself drinking the Bible. And here is our text for this morning, 1 Peter chapter 2. We're finally in chapter 2. I know it took a while. Verses 1 through 3. So therefore, laying aside all malice and deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and all evil speaking, as newborn babes, desire the pure milk of the Word, that you may grow thereby, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is gracious. Not a lot there, but we could spend a long time talking about this for sure. So let's begin by looking at a little closer at, let's go to verse 2. That starts with, as newborn babes, catches your attention, desire the pure milk of the Word, that you may grow thereby. So the word desire there, we've been talking about it a lot lately. Peter uses it a lot. Or the word epithumeo, as we've been learning, means what? It's a strong, passionate desire. Or in this case, it would be like to crave. Okay, crave the word. And it's translated in 2 Timothy 1:4 as greatly desiring. This verse is telling us that you and I must make a deliberate decision to deeply desire or crave the Word of God. And we must be intentional, because this won't happen automatically. It just won't. We need to know the Word of the Lord if we want to grow in the Lord of the Word. Amen? Did I make that clear? We need to know the Word of the Lord if we want to grow to know the Lord of the Word. And I should point out that the phrase newborn babes here, it catches your attention, yes, especially if you've come to the Lord later in life and you're thinking, well, He wants me to be like a newborn babe? What's that about? Well, this doesn't necessarily mean that Peter's readers are brand new Christians or brand new in their faith, not in this context. In this context, milk doesn't refer to as much to the basic elementary teachings in the Bible, like it does in Hebrews 5, 12 through 13, where milk is contrasted with meat or solid food, okay? Here, Peter is simply saying that all believers are to long for the word with the same kind of intensity, the craving that a baby does for milk. So if we want to grow spiritually, we must get the word of God into us. We must drink it. We must crave it. Just like the newborn baby craves milk, we must long for the word of the Lord. Now, a baby has a way of letting everyone know that it's time to eat, don't they? Even new puppies. They have a way of telling you when they're hungry too. And they won't stop crying until the craving is satisfied. A healthy infant is generally a hungry infant, okay? If they're not well, they're not too interested in food. No, generally, a healthy infant is one who is craving food. In fact, I've been told that a baby needs to eat every couple of hours. And, well, with guys like me, now in my second childhood, it's even more frequent than that, I think. But, you know. But like newborns, we're to go after God's word fervently and frequently. A spiritually healthy Christian is a hungry and thirsty Christian who eats and drinks from the Bible often. And I love what Job said in Job chapter 23, verse 12. My foot has held fast to his steps. I have kept his way and not turned aside. I have not departed from the commandment of his lips. I have treasured the words of his mouth more than my necessary food. So we see two things about God's word here. First of all, the word helps us to know. It makes sense. We're to desire the pure milk of the word. Now, the phrase pure milk means what? It's pure. It's not deceitful. It's not adulterated or watered down or mixed with anything else. It's pure. And, you know, the Des Moines Register ran a story about the tainted milk scandal in China several years ago. I don't know if you heard about it. But here's a summary of what happened. Middlemen who collected milk from farmers watered down the milk to save costs and make more profit. Okay? Totally unethical. To mask that, they also added melamine, okay, a toxic chemical that inflates protein levels to make it look like it was good, healthy milk. The melamine-tainted milk then made its way into infant formula. Eventually, 6 children died, and more than 30,000 people became ill because of this contaminated formula. And I guess I just use that story to point to there is a lot of watered-down preaching today by upbeat, smiling preachers who want to make everyone feel good about themselves. But this is toxic teaching. Toxic teaching, that's hard to say. No matter how good it might make you feel, there's melamine mixed in there somewhere. If sin is minimized in the sermons, in the messages, and the cross is marginalized, set aside, then God will not be magnified. It's as simple as that. This kind of feel-good preaching can be like a poison to the church, really. Oh, people are drawn to it, yes. But they don't have to wear their steel-toed boots to church because they're never stepped on. It's living your good life, the best life now. God loves you. Doesn't matter what you do during the week. He loves you and forgives you. And it's just all about that, isn't it? And we don't want to be like that here. We also don't want to be heavy-handed all the time. But we're trying to find that good balance that the Lord wants us to preach about in this church. This is kind of the feel-good preaching can be like a poison, as I said, or at least be sending a false message to the flock. Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 14 says, they have healed the brokenness of my people superficially, saying, peace, peace. But there is no peace. It's a falsehood. The pure spiritual milk of the word helps us know ourselves by pointing out our sin and correcting us and then also equipping us. In short, it helps us to grow, and that's the purpose. 2 Timothy 3:16, I'm sure you know this verse. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete and thoroughly equipped for every good work. So we need to read the word. It helps us to know. The second thing we talk about here is the word helps us to grow, ultimately. So as beloved children of God, as chosen followers of Jesus Christ, we need to be continually growing spiritually. I think that's not a big mystery. He wants us to grow in our faith, not just get our ticket punched to heaven and sit there and soak in our salvation. We're to grow so that we can go and tell others about Jesus in the power of the Spirit. Paul exhorted the church in Thessalonica, 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 3, he said, "We are bound to thank God always for you, brethren, as it is fitting, because your faith grows exceedingly, and the love of every one of you all abounds toward each other." They were getting it. They were studying the scriptures that they had at those times. They didn't have the Bible like we do today. But that takes away our excuse, doesn't it? With all the Bibles at our disposal. So our continued spiritual growth is vital, because it is impossible to grow in your relationship with God without growing in your relationship with God's Word. Peter refers to the Word of God as pure milk, and Jesus even said in Matthew 4:4, he said, "Man shall not live by bread alone." It's often called bread in the Bible. "But by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." Interesting that there are at least three food metaphors used for the Word of God, the Bible, in the Scriptures. In 1 Peter 2:2, it's milk that we're studying today. In Hebrews 5:11 through 14, it's called the meat of the word. And in Psalm 19:10, it's the honey, honey on your lips. I mean, are you getting hungry yet? Well, I hope you are, because we're going to talk about how to perk up your appetite for the Word of God. And before you mentally check out because now you're feeling guilty for not craving God's Word, we're all there at some point or another, okay? So let's spend the rest of our time this morning answering the how question. And what is that? Well, an honest question here would be, how then do I make myself crave pure spiritual milk? Or you might say, I come away from every sermon determined to do better, and I do desire to read and pray, but then I don't do it. Is craving a gift from God? Or do I have to summon it up in myself? How do I learn how to crave? And these are good questions. Well, our passage today gives us three ways to cultivate a craving for the Word of God. Now, we started in verse 2, and now we're going to go back to verse 1, and then we'll go forward to verse 3. Kind of jumping around a little this morning, but first of all, I would say the key thing, the very primary thing that we should do if we're trying to learn how to crave the Word is to remember our salvation. That's really the starting place. Again, in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 1, he starts with that word, therefore. That means we need to go back a few more verses to see what Peter has said previously. And remember that there were no chapter divisions in the original Greek manuscripts. In the Greek, it was simply these long flowing lines of capital letters. No paragraph breaks, no sentence breaks, and no punctuation. Three times in these verses, we read of the importance and the primacy of the Word. In these three key areas, we are born again through the living and abiding Word of God. Secondly, the word of the Lord stands forever. It doesn't change. And the word was preached to us. What does that mean? Well, that's why we're sitting here saved this morning. You heard the word of God. The Holy Spirit worked with that word that you had heard and gave you enough information to want to accept Christ. Look, if you're feeling disconnected and dry in your Christian experience, then I suggest you travel back and remember your spiritual birthday. Now, some people don't have a spiritual birthday in their minds. Well, I've always been a Christian. Or, you know, it kind of took place over a couple of years. So you may not have an actual date or a time. That's not important. The important thing is Christ got a hold of your heart and you surrendered it to him. That's your spiritual birthday, whenever that happened. But you will remember that time when you came to Christ and the excitement you felt. How wonderful that is. The word of God that led you to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ is the very same word that will help you to grow in Christ. So you could say that the word that saved us to Christ is the same word that will sustain us in Christ. If you're not saved yet this morning, that may explain why you're struggling to understand the Bible. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14 says that the natural man, or the unsaved man, does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him. Nor can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. Now the Holy Spirit becomes involved when you are saved. He comes to dwell in you, and he enables you then to understand the Bible. But if you're not saved, you don't have that Holy Spirit to teach you and train you and guide you. So first of all, remember your salvation. Secondly, to learn how to crave the Word of God, remove sin from your life. Check out the rest of verse 1. It says, laying aside all malice and deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and all evil speaking. And notice something here. All of the sins that Peter mentions in this verse, they're relational sins, or sins that are committed against others. And these sorts of sins can inhibit your spiritual growth and therefore dampen your desire to long for it, even understand God's word. That little set of five sins, relational sins, I hope you don't find yourself in that list, but maybe you do. And I'm sure I have been in there myself. So, to be quite honest, is it possible that the reason you're not craving God's word is because there's just too much of the world in you? It's like filling up your belly, this happens to me all the time, with so much junk food that you get a stomachache, and then what happens? Well, you no longer are craving for healthy food. Even healthy food doesn't look good to you. Spiritual junk food can take your joy away and your craving for God's word. So what we're putting into ourselves, if it's not related to God's word and his spirit and all of that, and we're just only taking the world in, we're not going to have much of a desire to read the word. So Peter lists these five unhealthy vices that include both attitudes and actions that are often even demonstrated among Christians. We could call them community busters or fellowship busters. Peter uses the word all three times to indicate that we're to get rid of every and all manner of these sins if they're evident in our lives. So let's just quickly look through them, okay? First one is malice. Now this is a general word that means evil-spiritedness, with the purposeful desire to harm others with words and deeds. It's the idea of having it in for someone with a kind of a smoldering resentment. May it never be, but it happens. The best definition I've heard is that malice is like congealed anger wrapped in an unforgiving spirit. 1 Corinthians 14:20 says that we, in malice, we should be more like babes. Okay? In other words, we shouldn't be that way. We should get rid of it. Okay? So, secondly, deceit. The picture here is of, you know, catching someone with bait, like dangling your fishing lure in front of a largemouth bass. All right? And it refers to a deliberate attempt to mislead others. Of course, as a fisherman, well, Peter knew all about deceiving fish. But the tricky part about this is that when you are deceiving someone else, you're actually deceiving yourself. Thinking that you will get away with this sin. Sure, the person that you're talking to may never know, but God will surely know, won't he? After Jesus calls the Pharisees a brood of vipers, he lays out this principle that I think can apply to us. Matthew 12, verses 34 to 37 says this, "How can you, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. A good man out of the good treasure of his heart brings forth good things, and an evil man out of the evil treasure brings forth evil things. But I say to you that for every idle word men may speak, they will give an account of it in the day of judgment. For by your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned." This is serious business. Malice against a brother, deceit, and then hypocrisy. Hypocrisy comes from the word meaning to wear a mask. You know, it's the idea of pretending to be someone or something that you're not. And that would be like me, trying to be this guy. Okay, all right. Now, how does he dance? Something like this? I don't know. I don't do a very good impersonation of Trump, I don't think. But, you know, I was pretending to be someone I'm not. And it happens all the time. It always makes me chuckle when I hear someone say that they don't go to church because it's full of hypocrites, right? And I often reply, well, then why don't you come and join us and we'll have one more. Yeah. You know, but doesn't it make you wonder, is this simply an excuse? Or perhaps this person has actually caught Christians being hypocritical. Probably. Something to ponder. Hopefully that's not you. Hopefully it's not me. Hypocrisy. So, and then envy. It's interesting that this little tiny word, envy, it actually makes the list of the seven deadly sins. Why? Because envy is not only wanting what someone else has, but it is more so internally hating that person for having what you desire. It's much bigger than the little word that it is, and it's much more detrimental to your relationship and your relationship to God, and therefore your craving to read his word. If you're envying, you know, you might be struggling with envy if you're jealous about the success of others, or that you're happy at someone else's misfortune. According to Mark 15:10, you know, when Pontius Pilate had to decide whether to release Jesus or Barabbas, the religious leaders were envious of Jesus' popularity, and that's why they conspired to kill him. It says in Mark 15:10, "Do you want me to release to you the King of the Jews?" asked Pilate, knowing it was out of envy that the chief priests had handed Jesus over to him. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have Pilate release Barabbas, a known murderer, instead. And then finally, our fifth one, we've got malice, deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and then evil speaking. And this is also translated in some places as slander, okay? And it includes all kinds of unkind speech and literally means to run someone down, especially behind their back, okay? That's usually where this happens, behind their back. And today, the sin of oh, backbiting or backstabbing, I believe is still way too prevalent among believers. This includes everything from idle gossip, even idle gossip kind of couched in a prayer. You know how that works at the prayer meeting? Pointing out the sins of others so that everyone else knows. In a prayer? Really? We think we're being so sneaky. You hear that at a prayer meeting and you hear them calling someone else down while supposedly talking to the Lord. I mean, really? Come on. That doesn't honor him at all. So you're either doing idle gossip or vicious spreading of rumors. And so that whole list of five relational sins is you know, pretty tough. Listen, it's quite possible that the reason you're stalled out spiritually is because you have some sin in your life that you have not been willing to confess to the Lord. So remember this, your relational sins will affect your relationship with God. The sins you're holding on to can sour you spiritually because a bitter spirit will eventually get the better of you. You can be bitter long enough that you get this root of bitterness that it just takes over. Relational sins create a spiritual like dissonance that can keep you from desiring to drink in the Bible. As D.L. Moody once said, God's word will either keep you from your sin, or the sin will keep you from God's word. And there's no other choice. So make no mistake, the way we think about others and talk about other believers can and will short-circuit our spiritual growth. We can't really say that we love God if we're hating our brothers and sisters, can we? This is stated so clearly in 1 John chapter 4, verses 20 and 21. If someone says, I love God, and yet hates his brother, he is a liar. For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen, how can he love God whom he has not seen? And this commandment we have from him, that he who loves God must love his brother also. So then, back to verse 1 for a moment. The phrase there, lay aside all five of these relational sins, actually comes first in the sentence structure for emphasis. We're to lay them aside. It's a picture of someone actually taking off and discarding soiled clothing. One of the ways that they would picture this in the original language. One commentator said it means to cast it away with indignation. Not just drop it on a chair. No, throwing that thing away. And the tense implies that it's to be once for all, a once and for all kind of decision with a sense of urgency behind it. In other words, do it now. Get rid of it. Let me ask you, have you ever hated a sin in your life that has been plaguing you so much that you finally get to the point where it actually makes you sick? You hate your sin? That's usually the only point at which we're going to turn from our sin, is when we hate our sin more than we, you know, love God. So we want to love God instead. You have this moment where you just say, cast it away. Sin, I am so done with you. It's usually when you come to that point that you can turn and repent, ask for forgiveness and move forward. The early Christians used to take off their old clothes before they were baptized and discard them, and then they would put on a brand new set of clothes when they came up out of the water as a picture of being cleansed and leaving that sin behind. Listen, Peter is telling us this is an obedience issue. We're called to lay aside all those things that sour us spiritually. And we can't be passive or dismissive or make excuses. That does no good. James chapter 1, verse 21 puts it this way, therefore get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. Romans 13, 12. Therefore, let us cast off the words of darkness, the works of darkness, I'm sorry, and let us put on the armor of light. So, I guess the question is, are you ready to cast off or junk the spiritual junk food you've been consuming? I mean, it's time to trash the toxic trespasses we're committing against others and not let sin rule over us, because it will. Here are two precise prayers that David used that would be worth memorizing, I think, if you find yourself in this situation. Psalm 19:13. He says, keep your servant also from willful sins. May they not rule over me. Psalm 119, verse 133 says, direct my footsteps according to your word. Let no sin rule over me. Is there a sin in your life that's ruling over you? It's time to cast it off. Do you want to crave God's word? Well, first, remember your salvation. Second, remove the sin that's in your life. And that leads us to the third way to increase your appetite for the Bible. And that is refocus on the grace of God. If you're still struggling to stay motivated in your Bible reading, check out verse 3. It says, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is gracious. The word if there is more accurately translated as since, I believe. So more literally, this verse would read, since you have tasted that the Lord is good. Okay? And this is a quote from the first part of Psalm 34, verse 8. Peter once again, he calls us to lock into the grace that was given to us when we were saved. God is a holy God and made a way for us to receive forgiveness and eternal life through faith in his Son, Jesus Christ. Well, we need to get it into our heads that obeying God is better than sinning. And, I mean, have you noticed with regard to sin, have you noticed that the sweetness of sin at the beginning will lead to sourness in the end? It never pays off. It may feel good at the moment, but it never pays off. And God's grace is so much better than the garbage we accumulate in our lives. You know, some of us have such a faulty view of God that we're almost afraid to read the scriptures because we think God is just out to get us. I hope you don't feel that way. That's how it used to be many generations back in one particular church I could name. People weren't even allowed to read the Bible. And they would be fearful to even pick it up and read it because they would be so convicted. But we don't have a faulty view of God here. But here's some good news. God wants to meet with you more than you want to meet with him. He loves you more than you know. He is good and gracious. Have you tasted him lately? Taste a little of the Lord and you're going to want more of him. If you're struggling to read scripture, refocus on God's graciousness. How much grace it took for him to save you, bring you into relationship with him. When we taste his goodness, we'll eventually want to gulp down God's word. When I first got saved, I could not put that Bible down. I was just packed it everywhere with me. I would read it to a tree stump. I mean, but, you know, over a while, the craving kind of diminishes, doesn't it? So we're trying to talk about ways to incite the craving to read the Word of God this morning. So how do we put this principle into practice? Well, here are some practical ways to put this sermon this morning into practice. Well, big surprise, read the Word, okay? We have to start here, even though it sounds so simple, but how do I start? Well, you can start by scheduling a daily quiet time with God. I know it's hard to fit that into our busy, busy lives, but I mean, really? What's the highest priority for you? And you must plan this ahead of time in order for it to happen. It might be in the morning, it might be at night, it might be in the middle of the day. You can also download a YouVersion app on your phone or tablet. Then you can access God's Word wherever you are. You could also use a Bible reading plan. You know, there are many you can download on the internet. One study I read said that of over 2 billion Christians in the world, less than 30% will ever read through the entire Bible. In just 15 minutes a day, you can read through the complete Bible in 1 year. Wouldn't that be a great goal to have? We're not that far from January 1st. We might be able to catch up, and in this year, we could read through the whole of God's Word. And start small, because the more you read, the more you'll want to read. When you taste the Lord's goodness, you'll eventually want to have the full meal deal. So, let's not be like those that Jesus referred to in Mark chapter 12, verse 24. He tells them, he's speaking to the Pharisees, "Are you not in error because you do not know the scriptures or the power of God?" He was amazed that these spiritual leaders didn't even know the scriptures. And they're the ones that were meant to teach the people. So first, we must read the Bible. Second, we must feed from the Bible. And this is where plugging into, an adult Sunday school class like John Simon is, you know, taking us through right now. You're in Matthew. He's teaching at 9 a.m. on Sunday mornings, and it's so important. Or a Bible study led by Dwayne on Thursday nights at 6:30. Awesome study. Think about it. What are you doing Sunday morning at 9? Oh, I'm trying to get my hair done. I'm trying to this and that, whatever. 9 o'clock? It's not that hard to be here by 9 o'clock. And don't get me going on the kids being here with you. Your kids should be here at Sunday school at 9 o'clock. I can't say it any stronger than that. Whatever your reason for not being here at 9 o'clock, I don't buy it. The spiritual welfare of your children and learning about the Bible and about Jesus Christ is so much more important than anything you could be doing at that hour. I told you it wasn't going to be an easy message this morning. So, a good way to study the Bible is to follow this process. Here's just a couple ways you can do it. You open up a passage of Scripture, and you do observation. Then you do interpretation. And then the application. How does this apply to me in my life? That's just a very simple way. Observation, interpretation, and then application. Or ask yourself these three questions while you're going through a passage. What do I see? What's there? What does it say? And then what can I seize from it for my own life? Very simple. But you get in to start studying that. I'm going to do another study on word structure, and it may relate to the Greek. People have even asked me if I want to teach an introductory Greek language course. I don't think I'm quite ready to do that yet, but how important it is when you're studying the Bible to see it in its historical context. What did it mean to the people it was written to? All of these very interesting things. And sentence structure, right? So you start to chart a verse, and all of a sudden it comes to life for you because you see that way down here at the end, when it says, do this, it wasn't referring to somebody in the middle. It was, you know, it was referring to the guy at the beginning. Well, how do I know that? We use grammar. And it just opens up the Bible when you start studying it that way, and it's so much fun. And maybe we'll start doing a bit of that. I didn't probably teach that very well, but the grammar and sentence structure, it tells you so much more about the real meaning of a verse that you wouldn't get by just reading through it quickly. Okay, so we read from the Word, we feed from the Word. Next, we need to need the Word, okay? Do we need the Word? I think if we've established that, then this is important to us. We read the Word and we feed from the Word, but we don't do either until we know that we need the Word. Ask God to give you a hunger for the Bible. And here's an idea. You know, slowly read a stanza of probably Psalm 119. Every day for a while, just a stanza, and then add another one so that you become sort of saturated with this psalm. Ask God to give you a craving for his word, just like you have a craving for food or drink. Maybe even every time you feel physically hungry or thirsty, remind yourself as a clue that you also need the food and drink found in the Bible. I like what David said in Psalm 42, verses 1 through 2. He said, As the deer pants for the water, brooks, so pants my soul for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. Thirst, craving, wanting to commune with the Lord by reading his word and learning more about him. So now we come to our application. Heed the word. No point in learning it all if we're not going to bother doing it. When applying scripture, it's helpful to keep this acrostic in mind. And this is one that I use sometimes. It's specs. Okay? S-P-E-C-S. Is there a sin in that passage to confess? Is there a promise to claim? Is there an example to follow? Is there a command to obey? And is there a stumbling block to avoid? I think that really helps. Something like that, just a little acrostic like that to take as you're going through a passage of scripture. So don't delay to obey. Don't put off whatever the Lord is prompting you to do. And he is. If you're here this morning, he's prompting you to either lay aside those five sins or others. He's prompting you to get into his word, and he will help then to give you a craving to read more and more of it. So don't delay, don't put off whatever the Lord is prompting you to do. Psalm 119:60 says, I will hasten and not delay to obey your commands. And I've heard it said that delayed obedience, what is it? Disobedience, right? If God's telling you to do it and you put it off, you're being disobedient to him. Remember, verse 3 said, since you have tasted that the Lord is good. So are you reading, feeding, kneading, and heeding God's word? If not, then crave God's word like an infant longs for milk, because the Bible will help you to know and to grow. One last little quote, and I'll let you go. Yeah, we're doing pretty good for time. No, we're not. We're way over. Anyway, I hope you don't mind today. This is a quote by Stephen Cole, and it says this. Taste, okay, there's that word again. Taste points both to personal experience and enjoyment. I can't taste for you, nor can you taste for me. To taste something, we've got to experience it up close and personal. And then, once you like the taste of something and begin to crave it, you don't just eat it to live. You live to eat it, don't you? Let's pray. Well, we thank you, Lord, for this morning again. For this word about your word. And how important it is, Lord, that we learn your word, we crave your word. The more we learn about you, the better equipped we are to tell others about you. So, God, I pray that you will sink some of this rather hard message today into our souls and into our spirits, and we will be inspired by your Holy Spirit to pick that book up and read it more often. We thank you for that in Jesus' name. All right, will you stand with us, please? All right, we need to shake all that stuff off, don't we? So we're gonna be the old church choir here, okay? See if we can do that. There's revival and it's spreading like a wildfire in my
my heart. Sunday morning, hallelujah, and it's lasting all week long. Can you hear it? Can you feel it? It's the rhythm of a gospel song. Once you choose it, you can't lose it. Oh, there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. I've got an old church choir singing in my soul. I've got a sweet salvation and it's beautiful. I've got a heart overflowing cause I've been restored. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. No, there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. When the valleys that I wander turn to mountains that I can't climb. Oh, you're with me, you never leave me. Oh, there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. I've got an old church choir singing in my soul. I've got a sweet salvation and it's beautiful. I've got a heart overflowing cause I've been restored. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. No, there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. Clap your hands and stomp your feet till you find that gospel beat, cause he's all you'll ever need, all you'll ever need. Clap your hands and stomp your feet, you find that gospel beat, cause he's all you'll ever need, all you'll ever need. Yeah. I've got an old church choir singing in my soul. I've got a sweet salvation and it's beautiful. I've got an old church choir singing in my soul. I've got a sweet salvation and it's beautiful. I've got a heart overflowing cause I've been restored. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. No, there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. No, there
all right, well, hey, thanks for coming today. Don't let anything steal your joy. Get out there, tell people about Jesus, get into the Word, and be joyful about it. He's with you. We'll see you later.
There's no one like you. None like you. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise.